all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I think nature's imagination is so much greater than man's. He's never gonna let us
relax. We live in an in-between universe where things change all right, but according to patterns, rules, or as we call them, laws of nature.
I'm this dot standing on a planet. Really, I'm just a speck compared with a star. The planet is just another speck. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space. There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos can know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are others, and we've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
We're all connected to each other biologically, to the earth chemically, to the rest of the universe atomically.
I find it elevating and exhilarating to discover that we live in a universe which permits the evolution of molecular machines as intricate and subtle as we.
I know that the molecules in my body are traceable to phenomenon in the cosmos. That makes me want to grab people in the street and say, have you heard this?
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos. And know it's all. Just.
There's this tremendous mass of waves all over in space, which is the light bouncing around the room, going from one thing to the other. And there's more really there, really, really there. But you gotta stop and think about it. About the complex, you really get the pleasure. It's all really there, really, really there. The inconceivable nature of nature. To think about all of this, to think about the vast emptiness of space.
There's billions and billions of stars, billions and billions of specks.
The beauty of a living thing is not the atoms that go into it, but the way those atoms are put together. The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are away from the cosmos and know itself. Across the sea of space, the stars are others, and we've traveled this way before, and there is much to be learned.
That was the Talking Alternative Radio Encore broadcast. We hope you enjoyed it. Now, for the live shows, professionals serving community, talkingalternative.com.
evening. Welcome to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauver. I'm an employment law and business law attorney, and I host this weekly live talk radio show and video podcast every Tuesday, 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. on Talk Radio NYC. And the purpose of my show is to help small to mid-sized business owners, including startups and businesses that have been around for many years, to learn about and get clarity on the various employment law, labor law, and business law issues, and also the non-legal issues, the employment and business issues that many of us are facing today, particularly in light of the COVID-19 pandemic. And so in this spirit, I have guests every week who can share their knowledge and their experience and give helpful guidance and tips. And tonight, I am very happy to have my colleague, John Edwards, who is the regional practice leader at Paypro Workforce Management. John, welcome to the show.
Hey, Eric, thank you for having me.
Oh, my pleasure, John. It's great to have you on the show tonight. I'm going to give you a more proper introduction in just a moment, but I thought first I'd introduce the topic so our listeners know what they're in for this evening. And okay, so our topic tonight is called Creating Workplace Culture During COVID. And the premise here is that with the COVID-19 pandemic, many employers have faced a lot of challenges regarding creating company culture for their employees. Some of you might relate if you're listening tonight. The challenge of attracting, for example, multi-generational talent and following proper workplace procedures. And now with a new type of workforce emerging, there are opportunities as well for employers to build morale and to improve diversity and inclusion and have a cohesive workforce that thrives on socially conscious and ethical ways to relate to employees and to relate to customers and clients. And so tonight I'm here with my guest, as I mentioned, John Edwards, regional practice leader at Paypro Workforce Management, and we're going to discuss this issue of creating workplace culture right here on the show tonight. So with that, I'll just give an introduction more properly fitting for John, a little bit of background for our listeners to hear, if I may. And so as I mentioned, John's at Paypro, and he has been in the human capital management space for about 20 years now. He helps organizations with human resources, with employee benefits, and with payroll needs. John has both an undergraduate and a graduate degree in business administration, and he's a member of the Society for Human Resource Management, which we call SHRM, and holds licenses in property, casualty, life, and health insurance as well. When he isn't working, John enjoys spending time with his family, attending his son's lacrosse games, running, golfing, playing soccer, attending his daughter's cheerleading competitions, and volunteering his time with a nonprofit called The Final Salute, which provides honor guard services and The Final Salute during funerals for New Jersey veterans and their families. So John, once again, really great to have you here to share your knowledge with us tonight.
Yes, likewise. So thank you for the bio. It was really great. I am what they consider a cheer dad. So I love attending my daughter's cheerleading competitions and my son's lacrosse tournaments. So I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, sure. It's very nice. Nice to be able to, you know, partake in your children. I think we talked about this before, our kids, and I have a young son just turned two. So but I can participate in all his like little things each month that he grows and changes in daycare. I try to imagine what it would be like when he's 15 or 16 or 18. I take it one day at a time, but it's nice to know that there's those things when they're older that you can still enjoy with them.
Yeah, they do say big kids, big problems. And I'm starting to feel that slowly but surely.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. But luxury problems, I'm sure. But why don't I just jump into the topic a little bit, just to kind of cut to it here. So John, can you tell listeners a little bit more about yourself, like your additional relevant background maybe, and maybe anything that led you to the HR space that you want to share tonight?
Yeah, I mean, I do have a very cool story and how I got into this space. And I can talk. So if you need me to reel me in, just let me know.
I can talk about it. Go right ahead.
So my mom always wanted, and you'll appreciate it, my mom always wanted me to be, you know, a CPA. And she had these dreams, grandiose dreams, of having my own practice. That was her vision for me. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of on that track. You know, I was heading that mm-hmm. way until probably about junior year in college. I took a marketing class. I'm like, marketing, what's that? I just thought coupons and cute brochures. But along the way, before getting to that point, you know, I took psych classes and sociology classes. So I would bump into Sigmund Freud, not literally, but through writing, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. But when I took this one marketing class, it was consumer behavior. Mm-hmm. And I bumped into these guys again, right? Abraham and Sigmund. And what was pretty cool is we were doing a case study on the United States Army. And at the time, well, I guess I'm OG, so I'm dating myself. This was like the early 90s. Sure. Their recruiting efforts were very low. So their numbers going in were very low, and they were trying to figure it out what was going on. So lo and behold, through, you know, meeting with consultants and advertising agencies, they followed Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So the top rung, self-actualization. So they came up with this marketing campaign, Be All You Can Be. So from there, their recruiting efforts went up, and that really drive to help the recruiting efforts. So that's kind of where I kind of developed a very strong passion for marketing. However, exiting out of college, my first job, I don't know if I'm allowed to name names, but it was, so I was with an organization called ADP. I think a lot of people are familiar with them. So what was cool back then is, so we were doing consulting and we were providing HR outsourcing services. Mm-hmm. In the meantime, their recruiting effort was being an employer of choice. So I'm like, wow, here I'm coming out of college. I let my mom down right out of the gate, and it's good. Just do it right out of the gate. I never became the CPA, but I got my marketing degree. And when I was in ADP, just analyzing the situation of becoming an employer choice, I learned a lot. And, you know, I was consulting and providing these services, these HR outsourcing services from payroll, HR, employee benefits to clients. And you know what, that old mantra or cliche of hand the glove, it just fit. It mm-hmm. felt right. And I just kept running with it. And I stayed in the industry. From ADP, I went to other global risk management companies where I did employee benefit consulting. And we got heavy into HR, culture, total rewards. So yeah, that's kind of my long story, trying to keep it as short as possible. And that's why I'm still in this space.
No, I think it's great. You know, I think it's like just the right amount of time there in terms of your background, John, a little extra context and color for our audience. It's interesting how you mentioned like the how everything kind of fit hand in glove. But the interesting thing is that you were taking like psychology courses and sociology courses like in college, and then the marketing. And I can certainly see how the HR world combines those things, right? Combines like psychology, you know, there's that phrase industrial psychology, which refers to, I think, the psychology of consumers and business, or how companies work within employee structures. But interesting that those things were sort of a passion for you, and now you're able to channel into what you do in the HR benefits and consulting space. I'm always interested to hear like how people got into their space. You know, I've always had a passion for law, even as a small kid. And then in college, the creative aspect with writing and the arguing and debating and the analysis all fit for me. I will make a joke. You mentioned your mom, you know, letting her down with the CPA thing, tongue in cheek there. And I had a few friends that went through that when we were coming out of school. But I know for me, my parents put that, they never pushed me in a career direction. They always said, whatever you want to be is fine. But I was saying I wanted to be a lawyer since I was like 10 years old. So not many parents going to push back on that, you know. But back to you, you know, to your space. So you're in this HR space, right? You're here now. You've been here for a while, and then COVID-19 hits. And I'm wondering, you know, we talk a lot about like diversity and inclusion over the last like, few years, right? It's not just about you know the we being in the employment space, and it's not just about you know, avoiding litigation. It's about making an actual active effort to include people of different backgrounds. And I'm wondering, how are you, John, how are you seeing the term diverse and inclusive workforce being used by employers today? And I'm wondering also, like, how important do you believe it is for employers to attract a, you know, diverse and inclusive workforce in today's post-COVID workforce climate?
Yeah, so it's very, very important. So there's two cast of characters out there that I see in my travels. So there, and I, you know, I've maybe grown up with a mother that's from New York. Like, I'm full of these cliches. So the fake it till you make it, that's out there. So there are companies out there that are using D&I, they're as a marketing ploy. And I visit some of them, and we're trying to help them as well. And they're like, we're all into D&I, right? All into diversity and inclusion. But when you meet with them, you're in their conference room, and there's a certain color and there's a certain age, and you're like, yeah, you're not really doing D&I. And then you meet those that are, they're full boat into it. Meaning, if you hear we want the inside to look like the outside, then you know you're dealing with the real deal, Holyfield. So their policies are in place. Everything's in their handbook. They definitely are trying to recruit in all aspects or backgrounds and age. So, you know, even D&I even includes, you know, veterans, but it also includes race, age. Now the OG inclusive thing was like the lactating room. That has morphed. Some companies have moved. They're like, hey, bring you. It, you know, it used to be when you came to work, it was check you at the door.
Right.
Now it's bring you to the door. It's a whole different mantra. And companies are having healthy conversations.
Yeah.
Conference room conversation where they, you know, they want to hear what employees have to say. Like, air out pleasantly your gripes. You know, how do you feel? How do we change? How do we make this more inclusive? So they're leaning on their employees a little more to develop their strategy and execute and to write policies, employment policies as well. In addition, as you mentioned before, ESG, right? Environment, social, governance, wellness. Those are big cultural, I don't want to say hooks, if that's an appropriate word, because most generations, most age, most backgrounds love the planet, right?
Sure.
Like, I think you can get a wide spectrum of those that love the ocean. They want a clean ocean, right? They want a healthy, vibrant planet. So that's kind of almost universal, especially when it comes to governance, because the younger crowd and coming out of college. So what we experienced, they're reading about Enron. They're reading about Bear Stearns. They're reading about the economic crisis, the mortgage crisis. And they're like, holy cow, I don't want to work for companies that do that. And wellness. You know, wellness is pretty universal, especially in COVID. You know, mental wellness, financial wellness, healthy living. Yeah. That's huge. That's pretty universal, especially with the younger crowd. They want that. Even the older crowd, it's time. Hey, you know what? You know, I'm very seasoned. I got to watch my P's and Q's. I got to be healthy. I got to do the exercise and eat right so I can have longevity in retirement. So those are really hot topics and universal, and companies are starting to intertwine that into the corporate fiber of their culture.
Yeah. You know, I think I tend to agree with you. I see it a lot with clients as well, business owners. And I think that this idea that diversity and inclusion is more expansive than what people might think of originally. It goes beyond. It includes race and national origin, but also can include, as you mentioned, John, the veteran status, able-bodied, disabled, or otherwise able-bodied people, intergenerational in terms of age of employees. And I think it's, like, you know, interesting that you can have, like say, a company that might be able to, like, attract talent from all those different pools and not alienate one or the other. And I think that might be a great jumping off point of some sort when we come back. We have our first commercial break, if you can believe it. The time always goes fast, I feel. But we have plenty of time left, so don't worry about a thing. So I'm here tonight, Eric Sauber, host of Employment Law Today. My guest is Mr. John Edwards from Paypro. So when we come back, we'll be talking more about this, like, diverse and inclusive workforce and different policies that an employer can use to attract a healthy team of employees. So stick around. We'll be right back.
Are you a business owner? Do you want to be a business owner? Do you work with business owners? Hi, I'm Stephen Fry, your small and medium-sized business or SMB guy, and I'm the host of the new show, Always Friday. While I love to have fun on my show, we take those Friday feelings of freedom and clarity to discuss popular topics on the minds of SMBs today. Please join me and my various special guests on Friday at 11 a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a conscious co-creator? Are you on a quest to raise your vibration and your consciousness? I'm Sam Liebowitz, your conscious consultant. And on my show, The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, we will touch upon all these topics and more. Listen live at our new time on Thursdays at 12 noon Eastern Time. That's The Conscious Consultant Hour, Awakening Humanity, Thursdays, 12 noon on talkradio.nyc.
Are you interested in having a better relationship with yourself, others, and God? Greetings. I'm your host, Dr. George Andow, for the show, A Journey Through Into Awareness. On my show, we journey into the awareness that the mind of God is the true seat of our personal consciousness. We join together each Monday at 7 p.m., so tune in on Talk Radio NYC.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC. Uplift, educate, empower.
Welcome back to Employment Law Today. I'm your host, Eric Sauver, and here tonight with my guest, John Edwards from Paypro Workforce Management. And we were just talking before the break, John, something you said just I wanted to mention, but I wanted to get to the commercial break so we can roll into the topic. But I wanted to say, you know, I appreciate your pointing out something that I've seen in employment circles as well, that with diversity and inclusion, I heard you talk about how comparing to the old guard, right, and times now, it's not about, like, say, companies, you know, inviting diverse people and telling them to check their personality at the door, check their uniqueness. I think a lot of companies used to think that diversity, inclusion, and being non-discriminatory, they used to think of it as, well, we're colorblind, you know, we're age blind, we're, you know, we don't see color or national origin or religion, we just see, like, you as the worker. And I think the challenge there is that we're not actually then acknowledging and celebrating people's, you know, say, diverse, like, perspective, their culture, what they can bring to the table. Whereas now we're saying, you know, right, bring who you are, and no need to check it, as you said, sort of embrace it. I think that was an interesting point. And I think it's also, to some business owners, might be counterintuitive that, you know, the more you have discussions, like in the workplace, about these issues, a lot of people think, oh, that's forbidden, right? That's taboo. We're going to open up a can of worms for, you know, disputes and discrimination. But I think what often happens is that by having those conversations, it alerts people. It lets them know what discrimination is like and to learn about microaggressions, and it helps to clear the air. I wondered if that's something that you've seen as well, like what your thoughts are about that.
Yes. And so when it comes to recruiting, mm-hmm. Right, back to cliches again, birds of a feather flock together. Sure. So when you have someone from a certain background, whatever it is, age or race or cultural background, mm-hmm. So when you're in an environment, like you said, and I said, where it's open and these discussions are having, that resonates with that person of that background. So when it comes to recruiting, you know, and setting policy, you know, birds of a feather flock together. When those referral programs come out, hey, John, who do you know? You know, the typical recruiting thing. Hey, sure. You bring someone in, I'll give you like $500. But I'm going to reach out to like-minded people. People like me. So my background is Puerto Rican, Colombian on my mom's side, German and English on my dad's side. So I know these people, right? So chances are I'm gonna ask a bright, you know, someone that's from the, you know, Puerto Rican descent or Colombian descent that, hey, you know, I'm working for this company. And they're very open-minded. They're very forward-thinking. You know what? And there's a job position opening. You know, give me your resume. And it's very important, if I could just add one thing.
Sure.
Especially I learned in my marketing class. So we did a case study, right, on the Chevy Nova. And I'm bringing this up because it's important to have people from different backgrounds with a different lens. Mm-hmm. So Chevy Nova did a case study because they were trying to sell the product
right.
to the Spanish Hispanic community, but it was failing miserably. Mm-hmm. But everybody knows that the word vamos means go, right? And va mm-hmm. is the root word of go. Yep. And the car was Nova. Right. So if they had someone on the product development team, I don't know if they did or they didn't. Maybe someone could have sniffed it. Hey, man, you're not going to sell out of these cars to Hispanics because your car says don't go.
Right. So when you want for a car, yeah.
Yeah, when you open it up, it's very important that the boardroom inside looks like outside. It's just very fruitful for organizations to think like that.
Oh, sorry. You're saying, yeah.
No, that's my thing. Because everyone looks at problem solving, especially those are with engineer background, with a different lens. So they're going to bring different solutions to the table.
Yep.
And they're going to be the best of breed solutions. So it behooves corporations to start thinking like this, start moving like this, versus the old adage.
Yes. Right. Mm-hmm. So it helps them from an employment point of view with their employees and morale. I could attest that it helps, I think, in my opinion, like with a legal point of view, because I think that people are often less likely, like say, to lay a termination at their employer's feet based on discrimination if the company is more diverse and has actively recruited and has active discussions and conversations. But very often, though, discrimination still happens. Sometimes it's someone's fired for legitimate reason, but they perceive it as discrimination. Some of that has to do with maybe their own experiences, but sometimes it could be on the company because they didn't have enough of a diverse workforce, didn't have those conversations. I know it could be more complex than that, of course, too, but just an example of how to your point, I think it's like behooves companies, you know, to have a wider lens to look through. And you mentioned that in terms of, you started to talk about policies and practices. So I was wondering if we can get into a little bit, if you can tell us, the audience tonight, what are some practices and policies that an employer can use, let's say to attract a diverse team of employees. Maybe, for example, how do you attract, you mentioned a little bit about younger generation, how do you do so in a way that doesn't alienate the older generations?
Yes, so not to repeat, ESG is gonna come back up because, it really is universal. Mm-hmm. So the more seasoned employees, they're into it as well. Mm-hmm. A lot of them are, you know, baby boomers. You know, they grew up in that Woodstock era, peace, mm-hmm. love, and happiness, and that's where the whole thing came out. You know, the tree hugger and all that thing. So, a lot of them are pro environment. And guess what? They're in the workforce, so they are capitalists, not to the extreme, but they're capitalists. They want to make money. They want a vibrant career, but they also are environmental conscious and friendly, and they want what's best for the environment as well. And that's same thing with the younger crowd as well. Mm-hmm. So I would definitely revert to ESG and wellness because I think that's a mutual playground where people from all different shapes and sizes can come and really be able to break bread per se. And you know, it's the studies and the white papers are coming out that these are the cultures that employees are gravitating towards. So like if you're in HR and, you know, I'm sitting down with HR and I'll ask if they have a D&I policy or a plan, or if they have
Yeah.
You know, what's your current culture? How do you want to change it? Where do you want it to be? And a lot of them are kind of lost. They're like, I don't even know where to go. Where do I begin? So that's a good jumping point and a good starting point.
I think you're right about that. I think for those that may have tuned in late, there's a reference to ESG, you know, in the government's part, right? Ethics and, you know, slash wellness, health, and there's governance. And can you elaborate just what we're talking about for those that don't know when you say governance and within the context of a company?
Yeah, so governance, it really boils down to ethics. So, I mean, a lot happened. In probably a 20-year span, right? We had Dodd-Frank come out. We had the economic crisis, the banking crisis.
Yeah.
Enron, again, Bear Stearns. I mean, Enron, you know, so no knock here, no disrespect. So it was the atypical shell game.
Yep.
And employees at the time thought they were working for a company with a mission that they were part of. And people got hurt. You know, 401ks were lost, pensions were lost. So having a good ethic and policy in place to prove to, you know, employees that are looking to be hired by these companies, hey, we are an ethical company. We do believe in social issues out there. So we take that to heart, and we're trying to put our best foot forward to solve some of those. And we're environmental friendly. And it does, sometimes that doesn't have to be a severe policy or practice. It could be as simple as when it comes to building morale and team morale. I mean, hey, Zoom is great for team meetings. And, you know, HR, they get a little hokey for team building and morale where, you know, there's the bingo games and things of that nature. But some companies are moving to, hey, let's you know, following protocol. Like social distancing. So let's meet at a park. Let's clean up the park. Let's meet at a beach. Let's clean up the beach. So they're coming up with these creative ideas that are aligning with the environmental strategy.
Yes, you know, and they're actually, I guess, in that sense, they're building, right, teamwork, community, a sense of service. They're not choosing a cause that's going to alienate certain people because, you know, cleaning up the beach, right? Let's say cleaning up pollution, like, you know, like, who can, like, say, like, argue that's against their culture or their beliefs, you know, per se. I think it's interesting that, you know, we have these, like, policies and practices, and I think that you're right, the company should really look at how to attract talent by showing them that they can be trusted, right? Trusted as an employer and trusted as a company facing the world, so that, you know, when that employee goes out into the world and says, I work for ABC Inc. or a company, they don't have to worry that in a year that company will be all over the papers for, let's say, you know, stocks and fraud around stocks and everything like that, or investment fraud, you know, banking fraud, that there won't be a problem with, like, cooking the books. I've known colleagues who are younger and they started out at some companies that they thought had a good name, and the name got sullied and tarnished by, you know, a few folks who did some very inappropriate illegal things, and now they had a hard time, you know, saying I work for ABC company, because everyone's like, oh, is that, you know, were you in their banking, like, fraud? No, I was not part of that scheme that everyone heard about. So I think,
yeah, and that's hard to shake, because sometimes you get branded, you do, unbeknown to you, and then you're on that list, and so future employment and career upward mobility could hurt if you get, you know, positioned with the wrong cast of characters, per se.
Yep, absolutely. So I know we have a couple more questions and interesting issues to cover. It's just about time for our next commercial break. So I'll just let the audience know that once again, you're listening to and watching Employment Law Today here on Talk Radio NYC. My guest tonight, John Edwards. I'm Eric Sauver. And if you stick around, we'll come back. We'll talk about some HR-related policies and benefits that are vital to a company's productivity. We'll talk about a little bit about Paypro. So a lot of good stuff coming forward. So stick around and we'll be right back.
Hey, I am Joseph Franklin McElroy, host of the new podcast, Gateway to the Smokies. It airs on talkradio.nyc every Tuesday night from 6 p.m. to 7. Every episode is dedicated to memorable experiences in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park and surrounding areas. This show features experts and locals who expound upon the richness of culture, history, and adventure that awaits you in the Smokies. Tune in every Tuesday from 6 p.m. to 7 on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a cannabis enthusiast, a cannabis professional, or interested in entering the cannabis space? I'm Johnny Tsunami, and this is Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view. On our show, we will discuss the cannabis world through the perspective of various cannabis professionals. Tune in every Thursday evening, Eastern Standard Time, 6 p.m., Talk Radio NYC, Planet Baco Lolo, a less taboo view.
Are you passionate about the conversation around racism? Hi, I'm Reverend Dr. TLC, host of the Dismantle Racism Show, which airs every Thursday at 11 a.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Join me and my amazing guests as we discuss ways to uncover, dismantle, and eradicate racism. That's Thursdays at 11 o'clock a.m. on talkradio.nyc.
Are you a small business trying to navigate the COVID-19 related employment laws? Hello, I'm Eric Sauver, employment law business law attorney and host of the new radio show, Employment Law Today. On my show, we'll have guests to discuss the common employment law challenges business owners are facing during these trying times. Tune in on Tuesday evenings from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Time on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
Welcome back to Employment Law Today. I'm still your host, Eric Sauver. Still here tonight with John Edwards from Paypro. And if you listen to the commercials there, there's some great shows to check out during the week, Monday through Friday on the station. And interesting, you know, we heard even the show about, you know, marijuana from a less taboo perspective, which I think is like interesting because it does show a little bit of the changing times. And that's a whole other issue in employment that could take a long time to discuss. But I would say that that issue probably might not have been a topic on a radio show, a mainstream radio station, you know, 30 years ago, 25 years ago. So I think we have to acknowledge that the world is changing and we're really becoming more aware of different issues and looking at them differently. And so I think it goes to your point about how when we have a more diverse workforce, people bring different perspectives to different issues and could lead to some good, you know, good connection amongst employees. And I wanted to ask you a question, maybe leading into that, or that leads into a question, I suppose, around just talking about COVID-19, right, and the pandemic, how it's impacted businesses. You know, we have people working remotely, and I'm wondering, so when we look ahead, John, as we slowly eke towards normal or new normal, that phrase gets thrown around a lot, what are some HR-related, say, benefit-related matters that you believe would be vital to a company, let's say, for example, in minimizing litigation risk? Knowing that you're not an attorney, but, you know, your thoughts about that.
Yeah, no. So it's like, you know, jumping in a cold ocean. You don't want to just jump right in, right? So we do. We got to be smart about this. We got to ease our way into this. As you know, since you're operating in New York, there's the New York Heroes Act, yep. Right? So there are policies and procedures to follow that. And, you know, when it comes to the health screening, social distancing, hand sanitation, sterilizing the office, and personal equipment, respecting our space, and separation. Those are the practices besides, you know, knowing what the CDC has to recommend, the Department of Labor, And OSHA says, we ease into this. Yeah, it makes sense. It's just common sense to follow these procedures, right? Like jumping into cold water. Eventually, you're gonna get acclimated to the cold water. It could warm up a little. You get used to it.
Yeah.
And then, you know what? I guess we'll get close to normal, as whatever that is. But I think we'll definitely go there. So for risk mitigation, I would definitely follow those procedures. The New York Heroes Act, CDC, OSHA, the Department of Labor, follow those steps until the coast is clear, until we get to a point where whoever's making the call, you know, either the deltas drop, the cases are dropped, where the coast is clear and we're coming out of the fog. Definitely follow that. Now, when it comes to workforce productivity, right. So, you know, maybe because I've been hanging around too many veterans right now, I just got people in the military, either they're just true close friends or their family. So yeah, when, I don't want to say when war subsides and it's over, there is a mental impact. So for employee productivity, wellness, again, not to beat, you know, drum again, not to beat a dead horse. It's going to be forefront. So you're going to have physical wellness. You're going to have to deal with mental wellness, financial wellness. That will be a big topic, financial wellness, because some people, you know, including, you know, myself, I mean, financial struggles. So they're happening. They're real. And when we transition into the workforce, we're going to bring all that baggage to the work. So how productive do you think an employee is going to be when they're thinking about, well, my credit cards are maxed out.
Right.
I don't know if I can refinance. How do I clear this debt? I really haven't adapted well to the environment. I'm coming out of the environment mentally. I feel fatigue. I feel exhausted. Sure. So employers are going to have to deal with that. And you know what? So Eric, when COVID first broke out, right?
Yep.
I was running. I was doing a lot of running. I actually did a marathon last July.
Oh, wow.
But then I kind of fell off the cliff, and I got the COVID-19. I put on more weight than I should have. So, you know, as everything defrosts, right? And then the freeze goes away, you know, people are going to be exhausted. They're going to be out of shape. They're going to be fatigued, and they're going to be in a financial hole. So as an employer, the empathy, the human hat's got to come on. And, you know, how do we get these people rocking and rolling again? Like a war, when a war ends, whatever it was, World War II, you know, soldiers are coming back. They were just tired and beat up. Now there was a baby boom. I don't know if that'll happen, but but employers have to be cognizant. They're going to have to take that consideration. They're going to have to be lenient on workforce policies, and probably going to have to put in place new policies to accommodate these issues some way, shape, or form.
Absolutely, John. Yeah, I think really good points there. I mean, talking about some of the laws to follow with COVID, there are some new protocols. As you mentioned, the New York Hero Act, basically talking about having a certain standards for infectious disease, airborne disease, like prevention, and also, you know, safety protocols in place. There's also, as you mentioned, there are CDC guidelines around like social distancing at the workplace and, you know, socially distance. And there's back and forth around like mask wearing with the Delta variant being up. It's really important, I think, to follow like the rules, the guidelines, like the regulations of, you have the federal, state, and city agencies, and you have the CDC and the EEOC for employment guidance. You have OSHA, the Occupational Safety and Health Act or agency, that basically takes care of health and safety issues in the workplace. So you have all those regulations. You also have some new like laws and like rules like in effect, and so you have to follow those as well. I think it's like a really good point that, you know, one should be aware of all these different employment laws. I know that I've been very busy in the last say year and a half or so, helping companies to get up to speed with all those laws. What are these laws? Like, what do we have to do? What are our obligations? So definitely I agree with you on that. I think it's a great way to mitigate litigation risk, I'll say, and also keep the company's productivity, which kind of goes to your second point. How do you keep employees, right, productive? How do you keep the morale up? I think you hit the nail on the head, I think, in light of COVID, that, I mean, I suppose we can think about it, right? We can say that employee wellness and fitness has always been an important issue, whether companies realize it or not. I think a lot of companies think, oh, wellness is what employees do on their own time. They go to the gym, you know, Tuesday and Thursday night and like Saturday morning, whatever, three times a week, or they go to yoga, or they go to their therapist, like, you know, on Monday evening, whatever. But I think that what employers are seeing is that, as you mentioned, you know, coming out of COVID, in some ways it does parallel, right, being in a war. We're all kind of beat up. We've got a bit of PTSD collectively going from the constant, just, you know, the back and forth and the restrictions and the specter of, you know, mortality, like hangover ahead, especially in the first year. People lost loved ones, they lost careers, you mentioned, right, finances, you know, the economic recession. I think a lot of employees, like, if, you know, a spouse lost a job, they lost a job. So I think you're right. It's important to have, what I hear you saying is that companies should have an inclusive wellness focus, right? Help employees with psychological wellness. There could be, you know, employee assistance programs are in place. Interesting to mention emotional wellness and also financial wellness. I think often, again, employers often think company employees' finances are personal. It's their private business. And I think to some extent that's true. If they want privacy, you should give it to them, right? You can't legally inquire about, say, their credit ratings and in certain situations. But, you know, you can offer employees a benefit of saying, hey, we have, right, financial advisors to come in and talk about ways to save money or get rid of debt. Because as you pointed out, you know, if employees are distracted, right, say by their financial hardships, distracted by emotional, mental fatigue, that's going to impact their productivity, even their experience as an employee, you know. So I think you made some really good points there to kind of connect with. Like, employers should know that this is a time to expand an emphasis on these policies, not just to get everyone, you know, back in their chairs and back to, like, you know, writing up the TPS reports. If you remember the old movie Office Space, you know, but it's not just about, like, you know, writing out charts and doing what you're supposed to do. But so I think it's very interesting that you have that, you know. And I wonder, it might be a good segue into another question. Turn the mic over to you, of course. I've been kind of observing for a bit here, my own take on things. But I'm wondering, so how does Paypro distinguish itself from other HR and benefit companies? Like, what methods do you guys use that may have been successful, you know, with your clients during the pandemic?
Oh, well, yeah. So we are client-centric. So we're, even though we're a boutique firm, so we have national reach. We're not in every city like the big guys, but we are definitely very big regional. So we are client-centric. Not to beat a dead horse, we did build a wellness platform. So it consists of diet, exercise. There was mental MEMD, which is mental fitness as well, and telemedicine. So telemedicine, that we got a lot of traction on that, especially when COVID first broke out. You know, everyone was nervous. Everyone was concerned. Employees didn't really want to go to the doctor either. Because they just didn't want to sit in a room full of, you know, maybe potential spreaders. So telemedicine took off. We developed that platform, and it was a big hit for our clients. And they appreciated it because they were able to give a perk to their employees in a time where it was well needed. Mm-hmm. So how we're different? We're different because the way the firm operates, we're a staff of very seasoned people. Mm-hmm. There's a year break of how much experience we have in the industry. A lot of us have 15 plus years in experience. Yeah, yeah. We have some of my counterparts are certified professional payroll associates. So they have their certs in payroll. They have their SHRM certification as well, Society for Human Resource Management. Mm-hmm. I have other certifications, and I am working on a certification for culture. That's why it's top of mind for me as mm-hmm. well. Sure. But I have, like I said, all my licenses in life, health, property, casualty. I have my MBA as well. So Paypro, we're a staff that's well-rounded, and we're bringing not only academic philosophies to our client, but real world experience as well. And our clients definitely appreciate that.
See, practical and theoretical or philosophical. You know, you get the advice and guidance and the knowledge, but also taking into account pragmatic, real world concerns. What I hear with experience as well. Interesting, and I think we do have to take one more commercial break. We'll come back. We'll have until 5:57. Don't you worry, I'll keep track of time. So for everyone watching tonight, you're watching and listening to Employment Law Today on Talk Radio NYC. I'm your host, Eric Sauver, employment law, business law attorney, here tonight with my guest, John Edwards. John is the regional practice leader, at Paypro Workforce Management. So stick around. We'll come back more John Edwards. We'll be right back.
Hey everybody, it's Tommy D, the nonprofit sector connector, coming at you from my attic. Each week here on talkradio.nyc, I host a program, Philanthropy in Focus. Nonprofits impact us each and every day, and it's my focus to help them amplify their message and tell their story. Listen each week at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time until 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, right here on talkradio.nyc.
Do you feel uninformed about menopause and how it impacts on your life? Hi, I'm Pat Duckworth, women's health strategist and host of the Hot Women Rock radio show, Empowering Women Leaders at Menopause. Join me every Thursday at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, 3 p.m. UK time on talkradio.nyc for interviews with inspirational women who will share their top tips to rock your world.
Have you ever thought of reinventing yourself? Are you looking to create a new life's journey? Hi, I'm Kevin Barbaro, host of Coffee Talk XL every Tuesday night, 5, 8 p.m. Eastern on talkradio.nyc. Tune in live to hear me and my guests from a variety of different backgrounds. As a former college coach and a current full-time actor and owner of multiple companies, my show is as eclectic as my life. That's Coffee Talk XL every Tuesday night, 8 p.m. on talkradio.nyc.
You're listening to Talk Radio NYC at www.talkradio.nyc. Now broadcasting 24 hours a day.
Welcome back to Employment Law Today. Once again, I'm your host, Eric Sauver, here tonight with John Edwards, talking about creating a workplace culture during COVID and covering some really good topics here about intergenerational appeal, talking about expanding the term diversity and inclusion as we know it, and having solid policies in place that look towards creating a cohesive workforce that is up to date with the COVID-19 compliance and also is focused on wellness of their employees. And I'm wondering, John, if we could go back a little bit, touch base on an interesting topic, I think, in today's workforce about, you know, the different generations that we have all working together, right? You know, we used to have, let's say, three generations in the workforce at some point, or maybe they had the baby boomers, Gen X, and millennials. Arguably, I think at some point, when millennials were starting the workforce, maybe you had a few hanging on from the generation preceding baby boomers, the silent generation, but I think the baby boomers is such a broad category that it seemed to cover, and basically that, yeah, Gen Xers and millennials. And now you have, right, Gen Z, or the the alpha generation, like, coming out of the workforce. You have millennials who are now, you know, could be in their late 30s, and you have college graduates, and then people who are, say, maybe coming out of high school doing an internship, you know, maybe born in like 2003. So how do we, what's some ways that your company recommends, like, people have, say, conversations about, you know, keeping everyone in harmony, the different generations in the workforce?
Yeah, so I'm a big movie buff. So the movie out there, The Intern, with Anne Hathaway and Robert De Niro, that's a great movie, and that kind of sets the stage on how to really do it. So yeah, I mean, a team-based approach is always the best way to go. It's actually been proven even in the military, right? So you have different people at different ranks, at different ages, with different background. But You know, the mission and purpose has to be known, right? So each generation, they want to know that they're on a train going somewhere. And they want to know the mission, and they want to know their involvement and how they contribute to that team. And that's, you know, the team-based approach, and HR is even proving it out. The white papers are coming out. That's where the camaraderie comes in. Right. And it's a flat team approach. It's not like, you know, here, I'm the director, you're my team, and, you know, I talk down. It's almost kind of have that military field team approach. Hey, I'm in it with you. I'm on the front lines with you. I'm talking the talk and walking the walk. And that team approach is best because you probably have heard in the workforce, and I've seen it when I was at ADP, when I first came out of school, the employer in choice, that camaraderie, that team building, that theory of, hey, would you run through, and it sounds hokey, would you run through a wall for your manager? And that's a powerful concept, because that means you've chosen him or her, as the leader, and you believe in the purpose, you're forward looking, and you're hard charging to accomplish corporate goals. So that's been a pretty proven philosophy, the team-based approach to culture, camaraderie building, and productivity in a team environment.
Got it. So kind of people align behind a common purpose, but not having them feel as if they're one up or one down, not better than, less than, just sort of like all, say, spokes in the wheel, which I think is always interesting, because, right, you want to make people feel that they're even with their colleagues, and no one's less than, no one's greater than. And you also want to, say, maybe acknowledge someone who may have, you know, 15 years experience with the company, might have, say, earned certain levels, let's say, of, like, you know, leeway or credibility, or, you know, to lead certain projects if need be. But also to know that younger employees coming into the workforce can bring a lot to the table. I think that's an interesting, kind of coincides with what you're saying a little bit about, you know, just the, right, we're all on the same team and we're not trying to one up each other.
Back kind of to pivot to the alpha generation and the younger generations, they're coming out of awesome, beautiful schools. So we're seeing a talent pool, a large talent pool of highly, highly educated workforce, because a lot of them, like, we're seeing more numbers coming through MIT, top tier schools, Stanford, Ohio State, Michigan State. We're seeing more numbers than we've ever seen before. But on the flip side, right, the seasoned people like me, it's kind of like Heartbreak Ridge, Gunny Sergeant. We know where the landmines are. Like, we've been to tours. We've been in corporate America. So we got the hardcore experience. We know where the landmines are. So we can manage that talent pool together in a team environment to really drive the mission of the organization and hit goals, right? So even though corporate America could be touchy-feely, right? But there's a matrix, right? There's a matrix, a scorecard. There's things that we have to do to keep the company vibrant and moving in the right direction. So between seasoned talent and young, bright stars, working in a team environment is really the recipe for success.
Yeah, you know, I tend to agree with you on that. And I think that it's important to convey that, right, both types of aspects bring value. There's the seasoned experience, right? Wisdom is often knowledge plus experience. You really get it in your gut. And there's also even just the sharp minds being trained recently out of school who have maybe more update on different theories and such, had, you know, ideas to bring to the table. I think what I'm hearing too is, like, just the idea that people have open conversations. And I heard you talking earlier tonight, that is about just like the importance of, you know, letting everyone know they're important and they're all on the same team.
Absolutely. Because a well-balanced team, right, it's a number setting as well, but a skill set. So you don't want two people doing the same thing. So it creates that ecosystem, that engine where it's all firing on the same cylinder, but each piece of the engine is a critical component to the whole versus just the piece.
Absolutely. John, we have about a couple minutes left maybe, so I want to give you about a minute and a half, minute or so to wrap up, maybe just like share anything about how people can reach you, any interesting things you have coming up. The floor is yours, all yours.
Yeah, absolutely. The best way to reach me is via email, which is johnedwards@payprocorp.com. Please hit our website, www.payprocorp.com, C-O-R-P. When you get to the webpage, I'll be on there under staff. But when you scroll down to the bottom, you know, please sign up for our newsletter. We have a newsletter that goes out. It kind of gives the state of the state, you know, what's going on in corporate America, what's going on in HR, what's going on in our space. And there are webinars. I might be hosting some, but we're also going to pull in subject matter experts into these webinars. So it's, you know, it's very fruitful for our clients and our potential clients as well. So again, www.payprocorp.com.
And for those listening at home, Paypro Corp, right, PayProCorp.com, no lowercase and capital. That's where the information is that you mentioned. Wonderful. Well, John, thank you. It's been a pleasure. Well, we have a little bit of time to wrap up here. I'll just, like, first off, I want to thank you, John Edwards from Paypro, for being on the show tonight and talking to us about, you know, creating a workforce culture during COVID. Really helpful information. People can find this recording on the talkradio.nyc website. You can find the audio. Also, you can find the video on the Facebook page for the Talk Radio NYC station. So if you like what you heard tonight, you're listening to and watching Talk Radio NYC. I'm your host of Employment Law Today. My name is Eric Sauver. I'm an employment law attorney, and I'm on this show every Tuesday evening. I host the show at 5 p.m. to 6 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So please come back, tell your friends, tell your clients and colleagues. And once again, John Edwards, a great show tonight. Many thanks to you and have a wonderful evening.
Absolutely, Eric. Thank you very much. Excited to be here and I look forward. Maybe I can reconvene at a later point. So thank you, Eric.
Sounds great. Sounds great, John. Thank you. Take care.